Thanks for your nice introduction, and also many thanks to Cyrus for having invited me. So this is a joint work with Florian Klingmüller and Martin Bosch. Florian Klingmüller, he is also here, but not in the room. He has just finished his PhD, so any difficult question I will pass over to him. And all the things you like, he's responsible for, and anything you dislike, blame either Martin or me. So, and I should also acknowledge Willy Maurer and Frank Pretz and Eckhard Klim, Alexander Graf and Peter Bauer, because I also used some work of them, but I forgot to include them in the acknowledgement. So, what will my talk be about? So first, I will share some very limited regulatory experiences with adaptive designs in Europe. Then I will talk on multiplicity issues and type 1 error inflation. Hopefully, there will be some time left to introduce adaptive graph-based multiple testing procedures. And I will show the operating characteristics with a small simulation study and end up with a summary. So let's start with this question. How many adaptive designs have been seen by European regulators in the last couple of years? What do you think? Many? Few? So let's see, quite a lot in scientific advice. So what can you see here? So I simply put in the keywords adaptive and flexible in the EMA database, where the scientific advice letters are saved. And there you can see that there was a clear jump between 2006 and 2007 from about 19 scientific advice letters, which mentioned one of these words, up to 51 in 2007. And what was the reason? You may look here. In 2006, a first draft of the reflection paper on adaptive design was published, and there you see it inspired many companies to think on adaptive design and to submit proposals on clinical designs with adaptive designs. However, you never know who came first, the egg or the chicken, so maybe these protocols were already on the way and the guidelines followed after, so we don't know. And now I will focus on the years 2007 and 2008 more closely. And this is a joint work with Rob Hemmings from the Amateur. And you might have seen these slides on several occasions. And now this review of scientific advice letters is updated till 2012, but as CMA has not made it publicly available, I can only share the data till 2008 now. And how many have you seen in centralized procedures? And yes, you are right, just a few. Only some with sample size reassessment. Some were even pre-planned till 2008. And there was only one application with a novel non-trivial adaptive design with treatment selection. You have seen the reference on the slide of Eckhard Klim. It was a design where there were four doses, two active controls, and one placebo control, so it was quite complicated. But that this was an adaptive design, and this was not an issue during the assessment at all. Good. Now I will present you the result of the survey of the scientific advice procedures. And here we looked into the scientific advice letters from 2007 and 2008 more closely. And we focused on confirmatory adaptive design, and there we found 31 scientific advice letters, and we could clearly see that the number increased in the period from 2007 to 2008 compared to 2005 and 2006. And note that there might be some more hidden adaptive designs not identified by the search terms we used, because at these days, some companies were really afraid to use the term adaptive or flexible. So the design was really adaptive. In all the discussion we had, some said, no, we can't use the term adaptive in the title. We don't want to do it. So there might be some more adaptive designs. Does everyone know what the scientific advice is about in Europe? Okay, so Cyrus is shaking his head. So we'll explain. So in Europe, if you're not sure how a protocol should look like, you could go and ask for scientific advice from the EMA. And this is done by the scientific advice working party. And at the end of the day, you will receive a scientific advice letter where the question you have put to the scientific advice should be answered. And this is the difference to the US. So it's up to the sponsor to decide whether he wants to go for scientific advice or not. And it's also non-binding. It's only an advice. So it's then completely up to the company whether it takes the advice into account or not. So what were our findings? So first, we could see a broad range of therapeutic indications from HIV to type 2 diabetes to multiple sclerosis. So we couldn't identify that there's a specific indication where only adaptive designs are applied. But what was really interesting, that 1/3 of the proposal dealt with orphan drugs. And the vast majority were confirmatory studies, and this is not surprising because the scientific advice working party focus this is on phase 3. So that's not a surprise that also the studies that deal with confirmatory studies. And there we have seen adaptive designs in phase 2, seamless phase 2, phase 3 designs, and also poor phase 3 designs. And the most common proposals were sample size reassessment at this time, followed by seamless phase 2, phase 3 designs with dose selection, or the combination of both together. So 5 years ago, such a thing like subgroup selection was not really an issue, but I think it's coming now. And so you could also see there's a tendency to keep the number of interim analysis as small as possible. I think from the time when Pocock said in his fundamental book that in group sequential design, you should not do more than 5 analyses. No one ever applied a group sequential design with more than 5. And with adaptive designs, it seems that people go only for 1, sometimes for 2 interim analyses, but not for more. And this was also that advice given by the working party, that the adaptation should usually be limited to 1 interim analysis. So for example, there was 1 proposal where the company suggested to have 2 interim analyses, where at each interim analysis, the sample size should be reassessed. And there's the first interim analysis was discouraged by the working party because it was based on just 10% of the pre-planned sample size. And so it was said you can only be fooled by such limited data, just drop it. Clearly, as far as the timing of the interim analysis is concerned, there's a difference between safety versus efficacy. So if safety comes in, no one has something against the very early interim analysis. However, as far as efficacy is concerned, it should be later on during the trials. So we read it several times that the advice was given that the adaptation should be based on a reasonable amount of data. 2 early interim analyses are discouraged. And as far as oncology trials are concerned, it was always said since then, so survival data might be too premature that all the decisions are only based on early events and it might be too misleading. There were also 2 proposals of adaptive designs with the option to change the statistical analysis methodology at interim analysis. For example, 1 sponsor proposed to switch from a Cox proportional hazard model to a parametric viable model. And if I remembered correctly, this strategy was discouraged at this time. And as you can see, there's a wide range of other questions concerning adaptive designs. So, for example, which firewall should be used on the composition of the DSMB, or can the interim data be published, and so on. But however, this was the key finding which really surprised us. In almost 1/4 of all proposals, the EMA raised some concerns regarding the type 1 error rate. This was really a surprise, especially when treatment selection came in. And there, some sponsors had the argumentation, okay, we want to do an interim analysis. And as we don't test efficacy, we can spend full level alpha at the end for the final selected treatment. But as pointed out by Cyrus yesterday, or also by Chris today, this won't work. So we know it by heart now, and a lot of publications out now how you can address this problem adequately. Also with sample size reassessments, there were some problems, and some companies even proposed no adjustment at all. And one critical issue is also when the type 1 error control is simulated, also methods with strict type 1 error would be available. So there is a scientific advice working, but it was also quite reluctant to accept it. Why should you go just for a proof with simulations only if you know that there are some methods which would provide a full error control? And so Rob and I summarized it in such a way. Not endorsing adaptive designs without strict type 1 error control is not due to a negative position towards adaptive designs per se, but due to a positive position towards the importance of type 1 error control in pivotal clinical trials. So whenever there was concern, it was not really concerned because of it. They said it was an adaptive designs, but said there was no type 1 error control, which we usually would require for a pivotal trial. So at this day, so in 2010, we agreed that there are no contradiction to the reflection papers so far. And we also agreed that the European reflection paper is broadly consistent with the FDA document. It might be the case that the European one is very slim. It's only 10 pages, I think, whereas the American is 60 pages, 70 pages, I can't remember it now. So, and overall, you could really see that the scientific advice promoted adaptive designs in exploratory studies, also in difficult experimental situations, and they were also happily accepting it for confirmatory studies. And here you see some common issues which are discussed in regulatory advice. And now we'll focus on type 1 error control again. And we will look at multiplicity issues and how the type 1 error can be inflated if we don't control it adequately. So in clinical trial, we know that often multiple hypotheses should be tested, as pointed out in the table discussion, as a round table discussion before. So we would like to test primary endpoints, secondary endpoints, where the inference of the secondary endpoint is only of interest if the primary hypothesis can be rejected. We want to look into multiple treatment arms, subgroups, and we know that multiplicity adjustment is important. Even some guidelines say so. So what will happen if we ignore multiplicity at all? We know if we would test more than one hypothesis that the family inverse error rate will increase quite dramatically depending on the number of hypotheses. So you see, if you test 10 hypotheses, the actual type 1 error rate would be already 40%. And here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so 9 hypotheses. You see, you have quite easily 10 hypotheses. And things get worse if also adaptations come in. So here, we look into a situation where we want to compare K treatments against one control group. And now our question is, what is the most extreme inflation of the type 1 error rate using naively a conventional fixed sample test at level alpha at the end of a study if we allow sample size reassessment and also selection of some treatments at an adaptive interim analysis? And here you can see the maximum type 1 error inflation. And here it was a situation where we only compare one treatment against the control group. This was published by Broschen and Hansberger already in 1995, I guess. And he allowed a balanced sample size reassessment, which means we increased or decreased the sample size in both the treatment and control group in the same way. And here you can see the type 1 rate of 2.5 is inflated up to 6.2% with this kind of adaptation. So it's even twice the nominal level alpha. And now things get worse if we allow an unbalanced sample size reassessment, which means, for example, I decrease the sample size in the placebo group, but increase the sample size in the treatment group. And here you can see from 2.5, the level is inflated up to 10.6%. So it's quite a heavy increase. And now, if we have multiple arms, so here we test two treatments against the control group, the actual abnormal rate is 17%. So you can see, even in this quite simple setup, the inflation could be huge. So there's a need to adjust appropriately. This slide you have already seen. I've stolen it by Willy Maurer, but I should have also cited Eckhard Klim. And as we have heard yesterday and also today, the adaptive toolbox is quite broad. And now there's the question how to combine all three approaches appropriately to reach our goal of strict type 1 error control. And now I will come to the adaptive graph-based multiple testing procedures. So our motivation for the adaptive graph-based procedures is now we are interested in testing multiple hypotheses, and we know that there are contextual relationships between hypotheses. So we have primary, secondary endpoints, multiple treatment arms, and we want to achieve strict family-wise error control. And we know for fixed sample design, tailored multiple testing procedures are available, so gatekeeping procedures, hierarchical tests, graphical approaches. However, if adaptations are performed, like sample size reassessment, dropping of treatment arms, treatment selection, endpoint selection, again, these procedures may inflate the type 1 error rate. So we're interested in strict type 1 error control, and today we took out of the adaptive toolbox two different approaches. So to deal with multiplicity, we will apply the graphical approach by Frank Pretz, Willy Maurer, Bernard Brandt, and Martin Bosch. And to account for adaptivity, we will use the partial conditional error rate proposed by Martin Bosch in 2008. And I will explain both methods now more in detail. So what are our adaptive graph-based multiple testing procedures? They are a general framework to address multiplicity in quite complex clinical trials, and they reflect the relative importance, contextual relations, logical restriction of clinical hypotheses, like here. And now, in addition, we also permit adaptive interim analysis. This means trial modifications can be done based on unblinded trial data or also on external information. So this is now new. And I will illustrate the whole procedure on a very simple example. So let's say we are now in the late phase of a development of a new drug, and we are interested in testing two treatments, T1 and T2, against a control group, let's say a placebo group, and there are two endpoints, so one primary, one secondary. This means in total we want to test four hypotheses. So the primary for testing T1 against placebo, then the primary testing T2 against placebo, and also the same for the secondary. What are now the desired properties for multiple tests? First, again, the family-wise error should be controlled, let's say at 2.5 one-sided. And now, for assuming equal effect sizes, both treatments shall have equal chances of positive results. So how can we get such an appropriate multiple testing plan? And another requirement is that we want to test the secondary hypothesis only if the corresponding primary hypothesis is rejected. So that's what Bob O'Neill said for many years. There's no point in testing secondary endpoint if you haven't achieved statistical significance in the primary endpoint. And clearly, we also want to reject as many hypotheses as possible. So how can we do? Now we will use the graphical approach to address all these issues. So again, we have the two doses and two endpoints. So here you see the hypothesis for treatment one versus placebo, and here you see cybosis for treatment 2 against placebo. Here we have the primary, and here's the secondary endpoint. And now each node stands for one elementary null hypothesis. So H1 is the primary hypothesis for treatment 1. H2 is the primary hypothesis for treatment 2. Now we want to split alpha using equal weights between doses. This is the condition that if we have equal effect sizes, both treatments should have equal chances of a positive result. This means here we split alpha equally between the doses. And now you can see here the primary hypothesis for treatment 1 gets alpha over half, and the same we do for treatment 2. And initially, we give zero weight to the secondary hypothesis because we don't want to test a secondary hypothesis if we haven't rejected the primary. So initially, we set zero weight to the secondary hypothesis. And now we add an edge, and here, if rejected, reallocate the weight from the primary hypothesis to the secondary. This means this arrow shows us if we reject H1, this significance level will be passed over to the secondary hypothesis. And as said, we want to reject as many hypotheses as possible. So now, if both endpoints of a dose are rejected, then we reallocate the weight over to the other dose, which means if both these hypotheses can be rejected, then this treatment group can be tested at full level alpha. So now we have set up our graphical approach. I will show you a numerical example. So here we have the p-value for H1, H2, 3, and 4. And for example, now if we look here, for the p-value of treatment 2, it's 0.24, so we can't reject it because it's higher than alpha over 2, so we can't reject it. However, if we look here, p1 is smaller than alpha over half, so we can reject H1, so that's fine. And now, as we have rejected it, we reallocate this alpha to the remaining hypothesis, and the graph tells us where the significance level will go to, and here it goes directly to H3, which is the secondary hypothesis of T1. And now we update the graph, so you see we delete this node, and now the graph looks as follows. And you can see before H3 was linked to H4 via H1, and as H1 is deleted, it's now directly linked. So we have updated the graph, and now we look, okay, can we reject any elementary null hypothesis? Yes, we can, as now P3 is smaller than alpha over half, so we can reject H3, and now we pass the significance level to H2, and now, surprise, surprise, because we have selected the people in such a way, we can also reject the primary hypothesis for treatment 2, which initially couldn't be rejected. And again, we reallocate the alpha of the rejected hypothesis to the remaining hypothesis, to H4. We update the graph, so you see now we have full level alpha here. However, the last p-value is larger than alpha, so we have to stop, which means we have to retain H4, whereas H1, H2, and H3 can be rejected.
Franz, one question.
Sure.
You pass the alpha down with that arrow. Mm-hmm. What is the rule for erasing?
Mm-hmm. Yes. So you simply look, can you reject an elementary null hypothesis foreseen with the alpha which stands here? And if you can do so, you simply delete the node and you still want to keep these edges. And you simply, if this node is, goes away, you simply combine it, which means then you have a direct edge. Good. So the graphical approaches present really an intuitive way to construct and communicate multiple testing procedures. They really can see what is tested when, and it reflects the relative importance, contextual relations, or logical restrictions between hypotheses, and what's going on behind the scene. The graph-based procedure is a shortcut for a closed test. The closed test has been presented by Chris, by Susan, and also by Eckhart. So you might remember the closed testing principle simply says an elementary null hypothesis can only be rejected if all intersections where this specific elementary null hypothesis is part of is also rejected. And this is a nice way. This is really nice. The graph is now a closed testing procedure. So we know by heart that this will control the family-wise error rate at full level alpha in the strong sense. And the graph and algorithm implicitly define weighted Pomfroni test for all intersection hypotheses. And it's a shortcut that reduces the number of tests in each step. And a large number of intersection hypotheses are tested implicitly. That's a nice thing with the graph. So all these complicated intersection hypotheses are tested in the background. We don't have to care of about, because to achieve strict depth boundary control for simply testing four elementary null hypotheses, 2 over m minus 1 tests are performed in the background. And I want to show you how many. So this means first we have the intersection of all hypotheses of all four, which are tested with the p-value of the primary endpoint. Then we have the intersection with 3 hypotheses. Again, this is tested with the Pomfroni test of the 2 primary endpoints. Then we have the intersection of the primary endpoint of the first treatment and primary and secondary endpoint of the second treatment. And now you see, this is quite interesting, this intersection test is tested by the p-value of the primary endpoint of the first treatment. And this is tested by the primary endpoint of the first treatment and the p-value of the secondary endpoint of the second treatment. So you also have to care about these intersections. And that's a nice thing by the graph. All these intersections are automatically defined by the graph. You don't have to care really about these tests. So it's quite nice. So here we have 15 intersection hypothesis tests. Now we want to make some adaptations in an interim analysis. So again, we would propose simply start with a graph specifying the multiple testing procedures for all m hypotheses, and now perform an interim analysis where you, for example, might drop some hypotheses or change the sample sizes. And only for the hypotheses which will be continued, first observations are collected. And in the final analysis, the data of both stages should be used for the final test. And we want, again, the control of the family-wise error rate in the strong sense. And what are natural applications? The selection of treatments, or also the selection of subgroups in clinical trials. So let's come back to our example. Now we will drop a treatment at an interim analysis. So assume now that we withdrew the trial following some safety concerns. The trial data is unblinded, and the decision is made to stop sampling for treatment 2. So now we decide, okay, treatment 2 is unsafe, we will drop it. We're no longer interested. So this means here we drop H2 and H4. We don't want to test it any longer. And now there remains the question, how can we test H1? Because initially we had a different graph. So what can we do? A very simple strategy would be, having dropped treatment 2, simply accept H2 and H4 and discard the reserved alpha over 2, which was foreseen for cis tests, which means test T1, test the treatment 1 in a hierarchical order where you use a significant level of alpha over 2. So this is a quite conservative procedure, but we will know that this will control step 1 error rate if no other adaptations are performed. However, it's somehow a pity that we don't use this alpha which was foreseen here, and we also don't use this data. So there's the question, what could we do? What is our desired strategy? So we would like to use the first stage data from treatment 2 and also pass this significance level over to here. This would be nice. And optionally, we would also maybe relocate the sample size foreseen for cis hypothesis over to treatment 1 and the control group. So maybe we would also like to make a sample size reassessment. So how can we achieve full type 1 error control? Let's look again at the weighted closed test, which you have seen before. And now here you see the simple strategy where I simply dropped the p-values of the dropped treatment. And so this would be the simple strategy. And now the question remains, how could an adaptive strategy look like? And I will illustrate it for the intersection hypothesis H0. But the same works for all the other intersection hypotheses. And so originally, we said, OK, this intersection of all four hypotheses should be tested by a Bonferroni test with P1 and P2. And the simple strategy only uses P1 with half of the significance level. So can we use the data and the significance level of treatment 2? So the question is, can we use the first stage data from the drop treatment and testing corresponding intersection hypotheses? And the answer is yes, we can. We will use a method which you have heard of many times today. We will use the conditional error function introduced by Müller and Schaefer in 2001 and 2004, which says, okay, calculate the conditional error. What's the conditional error? The conditional error is the probability to reject the hypothesis at the final analysis conditioning on the first stage data. So here you see the conditional error of the intersection hypothesis, and here the conditional error is that either P1 or P2 are below the Bonferroni adjusted significance level. And the conditional error principles say, okay, if you perform a second stage test using only independent second stage observation at the conditional level, then you will achieve, again, strict type 1 error rate control. And this we will use here. However, says a caveat, for multiple hypotheses, one would need to know the joint conditional distribution of second stage statistics, which is in general unknown, for example, for multiple endpoint. Usually we don't know the correlation between the primary and the secondary endpoint. So there remains the question, how can we do so? I mean, there are some parametric solutions for many one comparisons, where we know the correlation which is introduced to the placebo group, but usually if we have several endpoints, we don't know it. So how can we do so? And here, we use the concept of the partial conditional error, and it simply says, okay, you can split it up, simply take the sum of the marginal conditional error. And for the calculation of the marginal conditional error, you don't need to know the joint distribution. And this is a nice thing here. You simply calculate the conditional error for the univariate test for P1, for the treatment 2, and then simply sum it up, and this is sufficient. And This means our adaptive test simply is the sum of the marginal conditional errors of the intersection hypothesis concerned. And here you can see now why the adaptive strategy is more powerful than the simple strategy, because the conditional error is always positive. And here you see the conditional error is always larger for the adaptive one, which means you will be able to reject more hypotheses in the final analysis. So here you can quite easily see that the adaptive strategy is better than the simple one, where you completely disregard alpha over half of the significance level at all. However, now it remains to define up to 15 second stage tests, and our proposal would be, again, use a graphical approach to define the adapted tests. So like here, this was the initial graph, and then in the interim analysis, simply set up a new graph, and then these new graphs gives you the weights how finally all these intersection hypotheses are tested in the background. However, however, what we cannot do, we cannot simply pass over the conditional error for the intersection hypothesis and then perform the test. That's not possible. Now we really have to do all these 15 intersection hypotheses separately. This is somehow a little burdensome. So if you do some adaptation, now you have really to do each intersection hypothesis on its own. So here, however, we can use the graph to specify the new weight for a second stage weighted test of each intersection hypothesis. So at least this graph will help. For example, here you can see now with the adaptive graph, we simply take the p-value of the primary endpoint of the first treatment, because all other treatments have now weight zero, so we know which p-value to use by this graph. Good. And how can we choose the final test? In our example, it's quite simple. Here, Q1 is simply the p-value coming from the second stage data, and now the intersection is simply rejected if the p-value from the second stage data for the primary endpoint is smaller than the conditional error rate of the intersection hypothesis. Then we are through. So how does the adaptive graph work? First, we define a pre-planned test using the graphical approaches. At an interim analysis, we perform adaptation based on internal or external data, so we can drop treatments, we can perform a sample size reassessment, and now we use the graphical procedure to derive suitable second stage test, multiple testing procedures, for example, by removing nodes of drop treatments. And this is a nice thing now. If no adaptations are performed, so if I decide in my interim analysis, no, I don't want to change anything, I can still use the pre-planned graph. So no price has to be paid that I foresee some adaptivity at an interim analysis. So if I don't want to change anything, then I can use the simple fixed sample size test, which I'm used to. Now I want to show you some results of a very small simulation study. So it's based, again, on our example where we want to compare two treatments against the control with the two endpoints. And now here you see the treatment one has only half of the effect of treatment two. So treatment two has a higher effect. And we assume equal effect sizes in both the primary and secondary endpoint. And the sample size is 80 per treatment arm. And after half of the measurements have been collected, now we will say treatment two has to be dropped, let's say for safety issues. So we will now always drop treatment two, and we will investigate these three different procedures. So first, the simple procedure, where we say, okay, we retain the hypothesis of the drop treatment, and we test treatment one hierarchically at alpha over half. So second one is where we use the adaptive test, and The third strategy is where, again, we use the adaptive strategy. And in addition, we reallocate the 40 patients that would have received treatment 2 to treatment 1 and the control group. So we reallocate the unused sample size of treatment 2. And here you can see the results. On the x-axis, you see the true effect size of the low dose. And the straight black line is the power for the simple procedure. And you see, by using this adaptive graph-based method and using the conditional error rate, the power is really hugely increased. And even if you relocate the sample size, the power will be increased further. And the dashed lines are the power curves for the secondary hypothesis. So this means here we have rejected both the primary and the secondary endpoint for treatment 1. As it is a hierarchical procedure, it's clear that this must be, that the dashed line must be below the straight lines. So here you can see, by using the adaptive method, you can gain some power if something has to be changed. And clearly, you can also use this method for more complex graphs, like here. Or here you have seen, yes, here are some examples for some more complicated ones. And these graphs are collected in an R package called GMCP, which was introduced by Rohmeier, Klingelmüller, and Björnkamp. And Florian Klingelmüller has also implemented the adaptive graph method into this package. So you can use this one. So our approach is suitable for general graphical procedures. You can apply it for treatment selection, for subgroup selection, for reweighting. So if you want to change, if there's a change in priorities, you can perform a sample size reassessment. And with the Müller and Schaefer principle, with the conditional error principle, theoretically, the interim analysis can be even unscheduled. However, it's not really clear if this would be accepted by regulatory authorities. So what's our summary? Weighted directed graph completely defines the adaptive multiple testing procedures. You don't need any assumption on the joint distribution of test statistics, which, as far as I'm concerned, is really nice. And you can adjust multiplicity from different sources. However, there's still some further work to be done. What we haven't done is a comparison to the combination test methods. It should be also extended to early stopping. Willy Maurer and Frank Brandt have now published a paper on graphs for group sequential design. So, and clearly, you also want to have some sensible confidence intervals. So let me end up with two more slides. What are the limitations of flexible designs? All the limitations which also apply for group sequential designs, like control of information flow, overrunning, and so on. However, there are also some specific limitations of adaptive designs. So extensive adaptations may affect the preservativeness of results. So we have a deviation from maximum likelihood-based test statistics. What do we do if the effect sizes are different in the different stages? And some people have said that adaptations may be inefficient. There are some publications out there, and even two people are today in the room, and so it's nice to see that today Cyrus and Chris have brought up more arguments for adaptive designs than I did. So the things changed over the last 10 years. And so my summary is now adaptive designs are a strict method to cope with the reality of clinical trials. They allow to address different sources of multiplicity, and they ensure strict type error control, because never forget, simply writing online protocol amendments only if design modifications are performed in an ongoing trial will not control type 1 error rate at all. Neither will do post-hoc analysis. And so our conclusion is to construct persuasive, flexible trial designs. Careful planning is required, so it's good to have a toolbox like EAST. And clearly, it has to be decided on a case-by-case basis if, again, flexibility justifies the increased complexity of flexible designs. So if you do all the simulations, you see a fixed sample design does a good job, so take it. And now my final remark, as it is a happy birthday celebration. Some other people asked, are flexible design sound? And Peter Bauer ended, is wine sound? It is the way to drink it that matters. So happy birthday, Cyrus.
Thank you, Franz. Are there any questions?
My question is, why is it not possible to include the adaptation into the graphics? You said you have, we have to go through all the intersection hypotheses.
It's not possible because each intersection hypothesis has a different conditional error. And so before, with the initial graph, we simply had alpha, which was passed around, but now the conditional error is different for each intersection, so we can't simply pass the first conditional error over to the next one because it won't work. That's the reason. We tried to do so, but we failed completely.
Frank, thanks so much for the presentation. Some of us who were not as familiar with the topic had some questions about your terminology. I wondered if you could go back to slide, I think it's slide 2. It's way back, I'm sorry. When you had talked about the EMA studies, go ahead, keep going. And again, well, I think it's the next slide. No, it's not the chicken slide. Yeah, what did you mean by centralized procedures?
Okay, so Europe is quite different to the United States. It means you can either go to national authorities, like national authority in Austria, or to the EMA, where you get the approval for whole Europe. And for some indications, you have to go for the centralized procedure, whereas for other indications, you can choose what to do.
So it's the regulatory centralization.
Yeah.
I just tried to understand your example. In that example, you dropped T2, and you still wanted to use the information, but you dropped it. It wasn't based on the data itself. Was based, as understood, it was based on safety consideration?
You could also drop it on based on efficacy. Doesn't matter.
So you had planned that.
No. We haven't planned anything. So we just planned interim analysis, and we decided to drop now treatment 2 because maybe the efficacy was not sufficient enough to deal with all the side effects you had, and so you want to drop it. So
what would you have pre-specified in the study that? We may drop.
And so you have to pre-specify the initial graph and the timing of the interim analysis. I mean, the conditional error principle would also allow that this is not, from a poor statistical point of view, even the timing of the interim analysis has not to be pre-specified, but if it's a pivotal trial, I think you have to do so. Oh my God, and Florian is not here.
You mentioned you'd be interested to compare with combination tests. I was trying to work out, before you said that, I think, what a combination test might be. So is it that you look at the graph and say, which value of alpha is the smallest for which I would reject something? Where do you get the p-values that feed into a combination test?
With a combination test, you can think of using tunnel adjusted p-values for the comparison of the primary endpoints. So this combination is, you really have to specify different tests for all these 15 hypotheses. So it's then more complicated.
But could they be related to the graph in some simple way?
Yes.
Is that definition appropriate to say you look at this, you look for this, what it would be, the smallest alpha for which when you go through the whole procedure, something gets rejected?
You don't have necessarily to look at the smallest p-value. You simply look, can I reject any of the elementary null hypothesis? You can start anywhere, it doesn't matter. So Willy and Frank have shown.
You want a particular p-value to put into some weighted combination. Mm-hmm. Not just alpha that you're interested in, it's where.
Maybe I miss completely what you're asking.
So from your your second stage, after mm-hmm. you've done the adaptation, I'm thinking of a combination test in the closed testing procedure. So how do I get a p-value for H1 intersect H3?
This would simply be P1, because of the hierarchy.
Oh, okay. Right. So, and then for something that got a bit more complicated, it was another formula.
Like for H1 and H2, it could be a Dunnett-adjusted p-values. For H1 and H4, it must be Bonferroni test, because we don't know the correlation between a primary and secondary endpoints. So depending. But so you know.
Wait to what I was thinking, but we'd have to. Yeah.
I mean, to reject an elementary hypothesis, you have to. So one of the adjusted p values will be the largest. Isn't that true? And that is what you were thinking.
But they don't.
Maybe. Yeah. Yeah, I think so.
Be the adjusted p value for the entire.
Okay, so there's something. Yeah.
I'm not sure if it's a combination that it's okay. A consonant testing procedure. I'm not sure.
Okay, so.
I think it's difficult to prove so far. No one has done so.
Any other questions? No? Thank you very much. So...